Those who ignore history are doomed to repeat it. It wasn't until about 1905 that George Santayana's quote became famous. But it didn't need to be said by some famous writer for the thought to cross through my mind. I didn't leave New York just to work for another man again. This was supposed to be a fresh start. I had people I trust with me now, and I had learned from my mistakes back home. Things were going to be different in St. Denis. I just had to play my cards right. Well, it's certainly been some time since we last caught up, huh? Things have changed quite a bit since we last spoke. I'm sure you have plenty of questions, and, well, I suppose I have some time to fill you in before I take care of some business. So, where were we? That's right. I believe we stopped at an offer of some kind. Is that right? Yeah, that sounds right. Well, here's what happened. Whenever you're free, I have a response, I suppose.
What's up, Mr. Dotty?
All right. If you want, we can talk up here real quick, Carlo.
Sure.
$3,650,
I think it was. Yes, it's
fascinating.
All right. First of all, I just want to say I'm honored to have been given the opportunity to join a family. And glad to have developed a good enough relationship
all in.
To the point where you're willing to offer this to me. However, Goggles and some of the others I've been spending my time with have kind of become like a family to me in a sense, and I don't know if I'd be willing to commit myself to another family after everything we've been through so far.
I'm going to put this down there as well. The invitation Biggin reached out to you was also immediately an invitation to Goggles.
Okay.
When it comes to the others, I just don't know them yet. But right. If they do, however, if I do get to know them and I do end up liking them, that invitation can also, at that point, be extended to them.
Okay. I do just have something else I'd like to bring up with you as mm-hmm. well.
Of course. You know,
with all that being said, I might have a bit of a different proposition you may want to consider.
All right.
And, you know, I'd like to preface this by saying, you know, I respect your family and everything you do for the city, and I'm grateful for the opportunities you've given me and my business so far. And, you know, I've greatly enjoyed the time that we've spent together and look forward to other interactions we'll continue to have in the future. I decided I'd like to kind of propose a bit more of a partnership that extends beyond normal business. So I think that, you know, my company and your family have worked pretty well together so far, and I don't see why that relationship could improve even more. So one of the goals that I'm trying to achieve in this city is to improve the nightlife. And you guys are mostly only awake earlier in the afternoon, and typically after the storm, the city falls extremely quiet, which is usually when, you know, me and my people are around.
Mm-hmm.
And so please correct me if I'm wrong, but I'd like to think I've made myself a pretty trustworthy and dependable guy for you all, and seeing mm-hmm. as you were willing to accept me into your family, I'd like you to consider this trust in me when I offer to keep an eye on things around the city later in the night when you all aren't usually around, seeing as how I'm trying to cultivate more of a late-night population in the city. I want to emphasize that, you know, I have no interest in having the level of control over the city that you do, and while the city's well-being is very important to me, my interests mostly only lie in the profitability of my business, my little office square around there, and the relationships that I develop and maintain with folks like you. A constant and clear line of communication would be held, of course, involving anything that might be of interest happening around the city from my end to yours. But to put it simply, my offer to you is a partnership between me and my people and your family to keep an eye on things while you all aren't around, as well as to extend our relationship maybe beyond just business that the public is aware of, whether that be taking care of problems your family may not want to directly involve itself in, or anything else. But regardless of your response, I hope this won't damage the relationship we've been able to build up to this point, and I'll bear no resentment if you happen to decline.
The bond that we have right now would not get damaged at all. I appreciate the offer. I am going to need to discuss this with my family before giving you an answer, but I think you understand that.
Yeah, of course. I did take a few days myself to just respond to your proposition, too, so...
Yeah. No worries. I'll come back to you in a few days, all right?
Okay. Yeah, perfect. There anything else you wanted to ask me about or anything like that?
Not really.
Okay.
It's all right for now.
All right. Well, I guess on that note, I'm going to head back downstairs and get another drink.
All right. Sounds good. You stay safe, all right?
Yeah, you too.
Perhaps after you have more fights, the people will know who is good and who is bad, and then there will be more bets because they know who to bet on.
I suppose so. I mean, we did have a... I think there were only... let's see, how many people... We had a lot of people who had fought in the first event who were fighting again.
Oh, boy. Also, yeah,
did the spectators know them?
What, lit?
Yeah, it was a bit of a different crowd. Yeah. That's for sure.
Let me guess how many followers
I've
had.
Attract reoccurring customers to ensure they will bet on the people they know.
Yeah.
That's true.
I've
very true.
18 fights.
Jeez, okay.
Won 40, lost 4.
Carlo, do you want to talk?
Shit.
Yeah, sure.
Alright, let's go out back.
Pretty impressive. Yeah.
Don't have to talk.
Not bad, that is it.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think of the outfit, by the way, Leo?
I like it. Alright, let's make sure we're whispering. What's on your mind, Carlo?
Well, I was just wondering if, Mr. Castillo had an answer yet for, my offer that I proposed last week.
Which was?
It's about them keeping an eye on Saint-Denis while we're asleep. Mostly during the next storm type of situation. Okay. Which is the thing, we are sometimes awake during that storm, just not oftenly.
Right.
I honestly have not been able to think about that due to the amount of fucking bullshit happening around us.
Yeah, that's kind of what I figured. With the whole Blackwater shit.
How many people do you have?
Right now, on, you know, the other side of our business, I have 4 people.
Are they trained? Are they armed?
Yeah, they're all armed. I would say...
You trust them?
That I trust, we have 3. I'm still... I've decided to keep a little bit of a closer eye on Wuhan and keep him at an arm's length. See, you know, kind of...
That's a smart decision. What is... It's all over the place.
Yeah, so, you know, obviously he's made some bad decisions when it comes to business partners in the past. So, you know, I'm having him do some smaller stuff on the side, you know, with some alcohol sales, things like that for me. So, you know, he's aware of a little bit of what, you know, me and my people do, but not a whole lot. So I'm kind of, you know, easing things in with him. But besides that, we got me, Goggles, Ricardo, and Isaac Blackwell.
Okay, well, as long as your team's trained, as long as you trust them, as long as they could be responsible, I see no problem with that. However, if we are around, we obviously take precedent and jurisdiction.
Of course, of course.
Then yeah, I don't mind.
All right.
You know the rules of the city, correct?
I do.
Good.
No bloodshed in the city, no taking hostages from Saint-Denis and using them in the store robberies. Store robberies are okay if it's done alone and is a separate entity. That's for the law to deal with.
Alone, you mean like one person? Or
No, like it, if it, can, it, it can be like a group, but yeah, like they can't take hostages to it.
Right, yeah, that's what I figured.
If they rob it, who gives a shit? But if they take hostages from Saint-Denis, if they harass people of Saint-Denis, if they abuse businesses or people, that's a problem.
Right.
And
right.
If something happens that is noteworthy, do let us know. When it comes to hostages, when someone does have a hostage, don't react immediately. If they took the hostage from Rhodes, then so fucking be it. But afterwards, just ask the hostage where they were taken from.
Right,
keep
right.
A close eye on who the people were, and try and find them afterwards.
Okay. All right, yeah, we can do that.
All right, good.
I suppose you could say I got the result I was looking for, huh? Well, at that time, at least it was. Back then, I couldn't afford to mess around with a family like that. At least not with just a couple guys at my side, and a mediocre amount of money to my name. This gave me exactly what I was looking for. Time. Time for... growth. With this time I had acquired for myself, I decided to put more of an emphasis on not only growing the Barletti & Co. business, but also looking for additional people to join the crew. Now, to do this right, you have to take things slow. And as a man of business, slow isn't always bad. It provided me with time to build up a reputation for myself as an honest and charitable businessman. I like to say it was because I'm quite the charmer, but sometimes people need something besides just charm. So I opened the restaurant.
I found my love in Portofino, perché nei sogni credo ancora. Lo strano gioco del destino a Portofino m'ha preso il cuore.
Growing up in New York, I spent a lot of time working in kitchens as a kid. And I learned a thing or two over the years. But the most important thing I ever learned was the Barletti family tomato sauce recipe. It's a secret sauce recipe. It's been passed down through my family for generations. And it's what keeps bringing folks back in. Now, I'm no one-trick pony by any means. But God forbid, if somebody says they don't like the food, yeah, you better like my fucking food. You don't want to know what happens if you don't like the food. You better not complain to the kitchen. Or you'll walk into the kitchen and you'll never walk out again. I don't want to hear one bad word out of nobody's mouth here. My meatballs are great. My pasta, impeccable. My salsich, superb. My fish, fantastic. You got that? My tomato soup, terrific. My wine, wonderful. And the liquor, lovely.
Ah, buongiorno.
Hey there.
Hi.
Now with the restaurant came new customers. And before I knew it, I had become a very recognizable figure. Between the boxing circuits we continued to run, the restaurant, and I forgot to mention one other thing. Is everybody ready? On your marks. Get set. Go!
What happened to Reddy?
Gotta get up there.
Shit.
Alright, folks.
Sure I had that.
And they're off. This will be a race of 6 laps. So, try to count while you're watching. It looks like Cody Calloway is in first place right now on mud. Don't tell me after all this time you forgot what I'm best at. That's right. In addition to the boxing events, I started up this thing called the LeMoyne Association of Horse Racing, or the LAH for short. And of course, we set odds on horses and hosted betting for these events as well. All right, Cody is approaching the end of the second lap here, still last remaining in first place.
Time I take betting advice from an Englishman.
Mas Blanche still shortly behind him, followed by Ann Wright in third place.
No, you told me.
And then the rest of the pack behind them.
Take the buckskin Mustang.
Oh, Cody is amazing. He used to be the number one racer in St. Denis.
All right, Cody Calloway still with a very healthy lead here.
One of them.
Let's go, Cody. Give me my money.
All right. Seems to have slowed down a little bit there. Finishing up his third lap here. In second place still is Mas Blanche. Followed by Ann Wright, who is just being taken over by Judge Detweiler. Seems like him and Boopy are picking it up. Vanya is picking it up as well. Followed by Maxime and Kira.
Come on, Chach.
All right, Cody still maintaining a healthy lead.
Oh, fuck, that doesn't sound good.
Alright, Cody still in first place here, very healthy lead, finishing up his fourth lap. And it seems like Mas Blanche and Anne, right, are competing for second place here.
Could first place just fucking stop, make it a bit more competition?
Hey, you never know, there's still 2 laps left here. A lap and a half.
I could have bet on Cody too. I'm so excited.
Watch his horse just fall and die.
All right.
Don't say that.
He's still got a healthy lead. Very healthy lead.
Wow.
Holy shit. Alright, he's done with his fifth lap, folks. I'm gonna head down to the finish line to determine the finishes.
You better go back.
You're done.
Done?
Yeah. Due to my rapidly expanding businesses, I was eventually privy to a higher standard of living. So I bought myself a new house on Million Ave. Believe it or not, it's on the same street that the governor of the state lives on. How about them apples? I was also able to start hiring quite a few employees to work under the various businesses I was running. Now, while I did need help when it came to certain lines of work, my primary goal was to ease new people into the crew. Ricardo had unfortunately been called back to Sicily due to some family issues, so adding numbers was paramount as we continued to expand. The first guy to come through this employee vetting system of mine was Isaac Blackwell. Isaac was originally from Chicago, and I eventually found out he had a very interesting past. He used to be a hitman for a bigwig up there, but after refusing to whack a civilian, he skipped town and headed south, where he ran into Goggles and I. After working security for us at the restaurant, he proved himself and began to get involved with other sides of the business. I will say, it ain't too often you meet a hitman with morals, but it's a funny world we live in. Up next was Patty Cox. He's from across the pond. He used to be a part of a prominent group here years ago and had returned to New Alexandria after a hiatus, looking for a fresh start. Patty had a good head on his shoulders, and he was a hell of a fighter too. State boxing champion, as a matter of fact. Hell, I once seen a guy take down 4 men in a row without skipping a beat at a fighting event out west, just to prove nobody else could stand a chance with him in a ring. Much like Goggles, Patty is smart, and I often pull his ear when it comes to different family matters. He's got some good leadership capabilities, which is why he's a figure of authority, after Goggles and myself within a group. After Patty, there was a long period where nobody else had been getting involved with the other side of the business. Eventually, we crossed paths with this guy who had the most obnoxious mullet from Texas. His name was Adam Daniels. Adam ran his mouth a bit too often, and still can't ride a horse to save his fucking life. But after working security at the restaurant and various events we held, we began incorporating him more into family matters. For as much of a stoonard he can be sometimes, he has been willing to do dirty work and doesn't hesitate in a pinch. He's also managed to clean himself up a good bit though, but we'll get to that later. Angelo Mancini was a fella from the old country who had left for the States and got involved with us. Believe it or not, the reason he left his crew back in Sicily was because he got caught giving a brajole to his boss's daughter while he was supposed to be gardener. Normally this would be alarming to me, but I found it too fucking funny to turn him away. Angelo's got some wit to him, and while he can be dragged into some stoonard activity with Adam and Isaac, he's reliable when called upon. He's also training to become a doctor, which will be invaluable to have as a part of the family. With a full crew in order, there were some formalities that needed to be had, and with it came the full birth of the Barletti family.
Alright. So, the way we do things back in New York, are, no, a little bit ritualistic, so to say. I do things, you know, everybody does things their own way. I do mine my own way here. But, you know, for those of you who don't know, I've decided that, I think it's time for both Adam and Angelo to start wearing a gold. I think, you know, Adam's put a lot of thought into his cigar business with Isaac. And I've been happy to see the progression he's made over the week I've been gone. And Angelo is working hard to become a doctor and has been available often and is, you know, has had nothing... nothing wrong I could say about him. That's not, you know, just a joke. So, with that being said, you know, the three of yous, we're a little bit too small for us to do this when you all came across paths with me and earned my trust. But I decided to do this now with everybody as a, you know, sign of our group and you know, our relationships together and trust in each other. So, all right. All right, goggles. Mm-hmm. Take your hat off. Right, Isaac. Patty. Adam. Angelo. All right. Now, I'd like each of you to take my knife here as we go around. Do as I did with my hand, and then you'll drink your glass of wine with the hand that you just cut. We'll do this all together. So, goggles, you can pick it up yourself. We'll be right there.
Got it. Matter which hand?
Left. All right. And the knife to Isaac. You're gonna take your gloves off.
Right.
All right, give it to Patty now. All right. Adam? Make sure to use my knife there, Angelo.
Here. Is someone... There you go.
Alright. Can hand it back to me. All right. Yeah, somebody dropped that knife.
Yeah, it was, I dropped it.
All right. All right, gentlemen. Now you can grab your wine glasses. Right, gentlemen, we drink this Italian wine with hands soaked in our own blood, a symbol of our brotherhood and our family. You are now tied to this family by blood through physical contact with myself and my blood on your head. This is now your... Like I said, we are now family. We drink the finest Italian wine with our hands covered in blood as a symbolization of that, while, the Don's blood rests on your head. But with that being said, gentlemen, salud.
Now that we had firmly established ourselves within the city, it was clear that things had been shifting. We weren't the only group on the rise. The Fowlers were a Welsh group that had moved into the old quarter of St. Denis. They were running a bar there, the Black Mastiff, and came to us with some plans of their own concerning their vision for the future of the city.
Why don't we come on this side of the, fucking cooking pot, and we can all see each other, huh? What the fuck is that?
It's maybe, like, where Tallgrass lives or some shit?
No, this isn't
nah,
this place.
Nah, he lives out west.
I don't know why anyone would want to live out west.
Yeah, I agree.
Alright, so... We did mention there was one final item, and that would be our plans for Saint Denis.
Right.
Yeah, me Ross Barris, we've been kind of thinking of a solution to a bit of a common problem, you see. The fact that predominantly the city is, you know, it's too restrictive for the likes of us, man. You understand?
Yeah, I think I understand.
Well, we thought of a small system, a fair system, that kind of reflects our views on the way things are kind of being dealt in the city. And we kind of thought that we would extend a bit of a proposal to you.
Okay.
So... Naturally, you've heard about the kings of the city, right?
Yeah. I know them well.
Yeah, exactly. And quite frankly, we came over here to the, you know, United States of America to get rid of a fucking king. We don't need a new one. We just don't need a king.
I don't think any of us need a king, really.
Yeah, that's why we got a president here.
Exactly.
Land of the free. And with that right, you know, you kind of get to do what you as you please. Free will, you know, self-determination. So here on my notepad, we've got a few proposals that would kind of fall under the idea of splitting up the Nice into new districts. Not neighborhoods, but districts of our own. And we'd call them wards.
Okay.
Dickie, do you want to lay out the map?
Yeah, I think a bit of a visual will help him out here.
Oh yeah, right on a big rack in the middle there.
Yeah, right. Just so everyone can get a look.
Where to put it? Just fucking somewhere here?
Yeah, right there it is.
Yeah, just...
Right, so on this map, we've kind of indicated in a few different colours an idea of what these wards would look like. Naturally, we assumed a little, a territory for yourself. But, you know, we're willing to, discuss such.
The one thing to take in mind with everything that's going to be discussed here right now is this is the first draft. This is going to be something that needs to be discussed between all parties involved, obviously. But, well, we came to you with it first.
Yeah, let me take a look here.
Because admittedly, I'll be honest with you, Mr. Barletti. The way I see it is you have more pull power. More power in general in this city than the Castillos. They've just had time on you, that's all.
Interesting.
Would you like me to explain the colours, or can you figure it out? And I don't know if everyone else can see.
Yeah, here. Get a little bit closer here, guys.
So, the blue on the map, that represents us, the Fowlers.
Okay.
The yellow, obviously being yourself, the Barletti, because you always seem to be in yellow, so I thought it was fitting.
Good eye.
And the red, the Castillos, considering that's where their office is.
Okay.
Now, again, all subject to change, all subject to negotiations, but Fred, do you want to work your way through...
Well, I've given Mr. Barletti a notepad with all of them kind of summarized and just kind of stated under 10 different commandments that each ward would, you know, agree to follow. And naturally, you know, we can discuss if we enact all of these or we edit them or we can add a few more if people are left a bit unhappy. So we've kind of shown on the map that, you know, would divide the city up into different wards. Within these wards, I think it's only right that we kind of dictate ourselves what's allowed and what isn't allowed. Because naturally, it's our own fucking territory.
Okay.
But that also gives you then the right to enforce your rules. You know, let's say fucking Dickie, you came into your restaurant whilst you weren't there and started trying to extort some fucking street rat. You wouldn't be too happy with that, being on your fucking turf. So you'd have the right to enforce your rules a bit. Additionally, we kind of stated that naturally the city is quite a big place. And given that there's kind of three major families and, you know, organizations, that there would be some neutral zones. Because, yeah, not every place needs to be fucking Dick and Charlie.
One example of these neutral zones would be the Four Horsemen.
Yeah, nice neutral place for everyone to hang out.
And some place we can all go, and whatever happens out on the streets don't really matter, because in there we are all equal. There's no, I'm the boss, you're the boss.
Right. Exactly, and for such to work, we think there should be a big focus on communication, diplomacy, because after all, communication solves many problems. Alright, so that's kind of a lot of the major points. There's a few more that we thought were pretty heavily up for debate. So we thought the idea of assigning a leader role for each ward that would also have an assistant. So disputes between these territories can kind of, you know, be settled between a few different mouths instead of a fucking army of mouths.
Understandable.
And naturally, with these territories, there's going to be, you know, obviously you ain't going to want us putting our businesses right on your doorstep, because that just gives you competition. So we kind of fought the idea of no businesses should operate in opposing wards unless there is an agreement between the two wards.
Out of respect, you know?
Yeah.
It's all about mutual respect and communication. And, you know, naturally, the territories that we've lined on the map in different colours, you know, we kind of thought, all right, well, let's say, you know, a year down the line and people want to expand their territory, we kind of thought it'd be wise that it'd be a bit more of a diplomatic approach, that at least 2/3 of the wards would actually vote in agreement to your expansion. Because, well, quite frankly, it's a bit unfair that someone just goes, oh yeah, I own 80% of the city and you can't do fuck all about it.
Right.
Now, of course, if diplomacy don't fail, there's other ways you might try and undertake to convince the other side to vote, that you might have a territorial vote your way in a dispute.
Yeah, yeah.
And on that, I think it's rule 9 called right to duel. It is sort of a rule put in place, so if there is conflict, it doesn't always need to be settled with fucking gunfire, because guns are loud and guns are bad for business.
Well, depends on the, if they're being shot or not.
Well, a fired gun, nobody wants to get fucking shot.
Yeah, because after all, like, if everyone's fucking going guns blazing around the city, all that does is get the fucking white hats pointing their fingers at us instead of the people out of the city.
Exactly.
But, say, if you have a disagreement with someone, maybe you can go to them and say, hey, meet me here, bring your best tools, and we'll scrap it out and see.
Yeah, like, who's like men. At the end. Like proper men.
Shooters ain't that common back where we're from.
Yeah, knuckle dusters and hammers is what we use back home. Yeah, and that kind of leads us on to the last point, the last commandment. We thought about adding a code of silence. So each ward vows not to rat on opposing wards to the law and order. Because after all, any attention by the white hats at the city is bad for all of us, not just them.
Hmm.
Yeah, I agree about that. That's for sure.
I don't think anybody here would disagree with that.
Yeah, I thought we'd all be quite like-minded on that idea. Now,
it's all subject to discussion, isn't it?
Yes, the goal really with this is to see if you lot are interested. And if you'll agree, well then, we will bring it to Castillo's. And then hopefully we can organize a sit down between the three groups where we officially draw the lines and officially set the rules. Because at the moment, I'll be honest with you, that map, all those rules, they were made by me and my brothers.
Yeah. Right.
no other input, that was all us, and I can see how one might think that's a little unfair.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's all about cooperation after all, so.
But this is the grand floor, I guess, we're offering you.
If I might ask, I live out of the market. I don't really want to have the market get, you know, fucked with.
I'm feeling that's why it's not colored here, I take it?
Yeah, at the moment it's neutral. It's not possessed by anyone. Maybe down the line someone might want a claim on it, but that's a problem for if and when. I can understand your concern there, Hazel.
Oh yeah, that's where me and some of my mates sleep.
Well, we've remedied that.
Yeah, don't you worry, we ain't gonna kick anyone out their own. That's the whole point of this.
Thank you. Just making sure, you know?
Well, you see, there's been a lot of thought put into this. That's for certain. And, I think it's a good idea, I do. I think there are, quite a few issues with it, though. Maybe not, you know, at least that I have, but, you know, I do have some concerns. I would say, I'll address the elephant in the room last here, but, I would say, first off, I mentioned that gun store, the gunsmith store earlier. That is something that, you know, we're looking to, you know, kind of have a stamp on, so to speak. And I noticed that it's in the Castillo's district here. I understand that their office is right above that, so I can see how it's a little bit of a conflict of interest, so to speak. But yeah, considering that you know, we are pretty heavily involved in a gun market in the state here, we'd like to ensure that we have a place of operation within the city that we live to, you know, carry out and let that business of ours thrive. So that is a major concern of mine. I would say that is the biggest concern of mine that I have regarding this whole thing, with the exception of the elephant in the room. But I guess I'll bring up the elephant in the room now. I have a feeling this is why you've come to me first. I don't think that the Castillos are going to agree to this at all.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's going to be any way of words that will convince them otherwise.
Yeah, I think you have addressed the elephant in the room. But, you know, sometime a king needs to listen to its subjects, so to speak. Especially when all of them are kind of saying the same thing.
I mean, king's only as powerful as his people.
Yeah, I mean, America's a prime example of that, eh?
You've kicked out one king. What's a fucking other? This is ultimately our goal, though.
Okay.
Carve out our own piece of the sea.
Right. I'll tell you what. We'll think this over. My suggestion to you in the meantime would be, at your own discretion, bring it up with the Castillos. Just gauge their reaction. And then, well, that might lead to a cause and effect chain, so to speak.
Yes, that's fine.
Whether it's a positive one or a negative one, we'll see, but I'm not entirely opposed to this.
Well, I'd say that concludes our hunt then.
I think so.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure. Really has.
It's been a great time.
Mm-hmm. Alright, fellas. Well, thank you for the hunt. I enjoyed it. I was
Me
able
too.
To, you know, have quite the success here, and then, you know, this was a very constructive conversation, so.
Mm-hmm.
I will, we'll be taking our leave here now, but, thank you for your time.
Thank you for attending, gentlemen. I know.
Yeah, thank you all.
It's been a long time coming, and I'm finally glad we've managed to get it done. I do hope we've given you some food for thought, and I hope you'll travel back to the city as safe.
Yeah, sure. All
right.
Mm-hmm.
Well.
All right, take it easy.
Farewell,
boys.
Gentlemen. Take care.
Take care.
Yep. Yeah, always farewell. Good to get to know your neighbors better.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Hopefully see you all soon.
Yep, see you around.
Yep. You know where
see
to find
soon.
Us. After a few weeks, it had seemed the Fowlers had finally had their meeting with the Castillos, who I was able to catch up with while spending some time up in a bar in Rhodes.
Hey Carlo, you got a minute?
Yeah, sure. Hey, Isaac, let's head upstairs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Get comfortable. I'm gonna grab Luca.
I'm going upstairs.
And you almost hit the opportunity.
I'm gonna take that as a yes.
Yeah, I think so.
No, he said I it's gonna be a slow
day. That I heard a Yorker in the room.
I can.
It's good to see someone else from that area.
Talking about me, sweetheart.
Yes, sir, I am.
Yeah, we've met before, right? You're Luca's sister. Yeah, good to see you again.
Good to see you again.
Barletti.
Hey, Lars, long time no see.
Yeah, good to see you. Could you say you should have gotten yourself an Italian broad?
Can I say what?
You should have gotten yourself an Italian broad.
I should have gotten myself an Italian broad. Is that right?
He likes your accent. I think he's having a laugh.
A lot of people.
No, I'm just
apparently.
Admiring the beautiful accent, that's all.
All right, how can I help you, gentlemen?
I just wanted to check in how you doing with your people and what's going on. How's business?
Hey, it's good. I've been slow. I mean, I've been out of the state for a week, so it's only natural. You know, we had the big state championship fight a couple weeks ago. That went well.
That's good.
And then, you know, going to be opening up the restaurant again hopefully tonight. And then, you know, Isaac and Adam here are starting up their own cigar and tobacco company.
Mm-hmm.
Very well, nice. That'll be good. And, yeah, you know, everybody's doing well, I'd say.
I'm glad to hear.
Yep, yeah.
Now, how about yours? I see you got a lot of new faces.
Yeah, a lot.
Really? Were you just, grabbing them as they come off the boat or something? Holy shit.
Practically.
Some of them are family. Like Nino's younger brother came around today.
Yes. Oh, that's who that is sitting down over there.
And,
what are you saying about me now? What's going on?
Some others so many Lars met when he went to Germany for a trip.
Ah. Italians in Germany. Interesting.
Some of them are Italian, some of them are British.
Huh.
All kind of sorts.
He does take your shit.
Have you been able to run into the Fowlers at all? I know you know, they kind
That's also what we wanted to talk about. We had a meeting with them.
Oh yeah.
We've come to an agreement with them.
How are the family doing over here?
Yes. They run the we gave them a piece of the pie, so to speak. They have the slums district as
their own. Take it easy, old bypasser man.
Love you, stay safe.
Thanks for stopping by, Mr. Sonia and Mr. Lip.
Sorry, say that one more time.
Anytime.
The Fowlers have the slums. We negotiated a piece of the pie.
I see.
Really?
Yeah. After a lot of talk and deliberation, but they're our allies.
We're not using the slums, and for that piece of the pie, they basically gave their allegiance to us. They will basically do the same thing that the two of us are doing, keeping the city safe and keeping our eyes and ears open.
Yucko!
Basically, when it comes to the three of us, us, you, and the Fowlers, we're basically a united front when it comes to the safety and the prosperity of Saint-Denis.
Did they mention me at all in this meeting?
They talked about you a little bit.
What did they say?
Nothing bad. Why?
Well, you know, they happened to have a meeting with me. I mean, about the, you know, some plans that they were thinking for, you know, the future of the city. Mentioned how they had their interest in, you know, taking a slice of the pie, so to speak. I said, and, you know, they proposed to me, you know, they had this whole map and everything, right? Had three different sections on it. It had, you know, one for, I guess, their area that you've relegated to them. They had a area for all of you, and they had an area for me and my people.
Well, I'll happily tell you, it isn't me you need to worry about.
Okay, probably that's...
The worst they never brought that up to us.
They're pretty bold of them to try to give away territory that's not theirs.
Really? Well...
And when it comes to, well, us, Nino's the one who in general, we already made the deal that we in some way kind of share the entirety of the territory as a whole.
Right.
We kind of keep the, right hook of my
the same territory the
multiple
two of us.
Time.
Yeah. And look, I mean, they came to this with me about, I don't know, three, four weeks ago, sounds right.
About then.
Yeah.
Recently talked to you?
No, not really, not besides, you know, the whole flamping thing. Yeah, you know, I told them, you know, you can talk to me all you want, but, you know, there's another group that you should be having its discussion with as well, and you know, I'll give you an answer about my thoughts, you know, after I've heard, you know, what they have to say about everything. You know, clearly it seems like you guys were on board, but it seems like they didn't include a lot of what we spoke with, spoke about in our conversation.
Hello, Jimmy, how you doing?
There you go. Oh, this is what they drew for us.
Interesting.
Exactly. Basically excluding you from any future fucking plans.
Yes.
Wow.
So you could see we were confused a little bit when you showed us that.
Yeah, I'm confused when you show me this, that's for sure.
I'll be right back, boss. You could show him.
Just need to do some very,
Jesus Christ.
Difficult number things.
The fact that the Fowlers thought that they could come into the fucking city and they would be the ones to split up the fucking territories.
Well, they're downstairs if you want to talk to them. Want me to bring them up?
I think I sent you a telegram, but Frederick? I might have gotten the wrong person.
It sounds like Richard.
I would like to very much discuss this shit.
Hey there, Fred. How are you?
Hey, gentlemen.
Hey there, Fred. It's good to see you.
Please have a seat.
How can I help you, gentlemen?
I wanted to get your... I wanted to ask you a couple questions, if you got a minute.
By all means, I'm all ears.
Can you take a look at this for me?
Saint Denis, yes.
Can you explain to me the colors that are described?
Well, from what I know, red is Castilla, and blue is, well, my folk. Yellow, that's just a color.
Really, it's just a color?
To some, yes.
Why was it that you can't... Look, you can tell me the truth, okay? We know. That's Carlo and his family's territory that you drew out for them a couple weeks ago.
Hmm.
So, either you're calling Carlo a liar, or something else happened, so can you please enlighten me?
By all means. As you said, that appears to be something that we drew up ourselves, as you said. Its significance, quite shallow, I'd say. The past is the past.
I understand that the past is the past. This is just that the thing that now jumps to my mind is, well, you came to the city. You wanted to draft up the territories in which you'd like. At that point, gave us, or wanted to give my family a smaller portion of a fucking territory than we... Because the thing is, we were already running the city. We gave you permission to get territory. But then when you come and talk to us, Carlo is suddenly no longer involved in the conversation.
And you drew this up before we knew each other, before we had our talks.
Mm-hmm.
You drew this up. You drew out your own territory and chunk of land inside the city. And you started divvying out territory to other people that wasn't yours to do. And I'm asking you why. What's your goal?
Well, as you said, this was way before I even had a chance to converse with either of you. Secondly, because of the nature of not knowing you, I wasn't completely complicit in understanding your status in the city, other than you guys kind of ruled it. But the location of that, I wasn't too certain. That's why not everything's colored in.
Okay, but why not tell the truth about Carlo?
I believe it's, from where I'm from, people fight their own battles instead of sitting on the sidelines.
That's not what I'm asking.
Then, rephrase.
Why is it when I asked you about Carlo, you just called it a color? And you had no idea what it's about until I had to mention it.
Because, as far as I'm aware, it still remains just a color, not a territory.
And this was a conversation you had with him to divvy out your own territories in the city?
It was an attempt to continue cooperation within the city, like ourselves.
How so?
Because just like when we came to you asking to protect your northern flank, why can't someone help you protect more towards the east? Well, west in this case.
And you think you have the authority and the permission to do that?
No. However, I do believe that I have the permission to think, potentially future, you know, propose.
Believe me, the issue is, and I wouldn't particularly say that it's such a big of an issue at all, but the thing that I'm more so confused about is you knew, and you just said that you knew that the, or well, the only information you had that we were running the city. That doesn't mean a small part of the city. That means the entirety of the city. Then when you move into the city, you go up to another family within this city, and you discuss splitting up territories with them, and you don't involve the entirety at that point. You already discussed something with him, because let's say if he were to have said, yes, I'm okay with this, what would that have meant? It wouldn't have meant anything.
It would have remained the same strategy as we imposed in the current agreement of sitting you guys down and speaking. However, Mr. Barletti was quite, how can I put it kindly, cautious.
How so?
Well, you know, they're saying big fuck small. He didn't want to get involved. He wanted us to be on the chopping block in case you guys said no. See it as liability.
Well, that's not exactly right there, Fred. Then I said...
Carlo, hold on. Carlo, you're going to speak. You speak.
Well, I said to him, look, I have no issues with this. But, you know, there's a third party involved. I think that, you know, we shouldn't have this conversation when it's just two out of the three territories that you're designating here. So what I assumed was going to happen was that they were going to have a meeting with all three of us, or at least, you know, tell you something about how they had spoken to me about this, and that, you know, if you were on board with it, then I was on board with it. But, you know, I guess I walked away from that meeting assuming that all three groups would be discussing this together at the same time.
Well, of course. Then what do you propose to make a solution to this conversation?
Right now, what my solution is, me and my family will discuss a few things. As we do already have a deal in place with Mr. Barletti, in the sense that originally when the idea was for when we weren't around during later times, they would take care of the city in the same way that we would. However, him and his family have also been growing, and I do think that they do deserve some kind of territory to call their own. Same rules apply in the same way that we have it. However, I would need to discuss what territory would be theirs, how much, and we will discuss it at that point. When that point has, when we have come to a conclusion, me and Mr. Barletti, or Leo, me and Mr. Barletti will have a meeting ourselves, discussing this amongst ourselves, maybe negotiate a little bit, and when that is all done, I would suggest having a meeting with all three of our families, and just to make sure that everybody knows what's what.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think, Carlo?
Alright, that's fine with me.
Leo?
As you say, boss.
Mr. Fowler?
Communication thrives, so yes.
Alright, then that's how we're going to do things.
So I just have some drinks for you there.
Thank you.
those slimy fucks had crossed the line. And it seemed like there was a storm beginning to brew over Saint-Denis. Shortly after, though, the Castiles came back to me with an offer of their own.
Considering the talk we just had, we wanted to let you know something, Carlo.
Okay.
If you want the territory for your own business, for your own family, for your own thing, you have permission to do so. And we would like to enact that now if you want.
Okay. I mean, yeah, I'm not gonna turn that down. I do want to say, I think you overheard when we were talking to Fred about how, he left out, there's a little piece, just to the right of the doctor's office, we got the whole soup kitchen behind the doctor's office there. Mm-hmm. If you keep going towards the river, there's another little neighborhood back there. Would that be all right to just kind of add on to the end as well?
For you, yes.
All right. Yeah, that was my only. That was the only thing that I had an issue with when they came to me. I mean, it didn't really make sense, at least in the way I was looking at it, for that to just be like an open territory.
Yeah, it's a bit of a clusterfuck between that situation and the Fowlers, but
yeah,
you've more than earned your keep and your share and your say in the city, and you've done such a tremendous job bringing in business, protecting people, and doing your thing, and we greatly appreciate it from our family to yours. So we would like to, officially and humbly give you that territory, no problem. And you're free to do business as you see fit in the territory. We do have overarching authority if things happen. But outside of that, we trust you enough to, give you all that.
Right, right. Well, I appreciate it. I know this has kind of been a whole fucking mess for you, I'm sure.
It's been a mess, I'm not gonna lie, but with you and your boys being friends, and we'd like to, with coming with the territory, we'd like to officially offer to be allies as our families in both conflict and otherwise, to help you out in conflict, business, anything, and it'd be mutual both ways in warfare and conflict and hunting down people and taking care of business. We want to help each other out. Does that seem agreeable to you?
Yeah, I have no issues with that. I do want to know, if you don't mind divulging, if you made a similar pact with the Fowlers when you made their original agreement with them.
There, when we had the conversation, we had an actual meeting that lasted over an hour to discuss with them, get to know them, and get their plans.
Right.
We've known you for so long and trust you so much, we're coming in and we're just giving it to you. You need to understand that while there are some things in motion right now that we can't discuss at this time regarding them.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to make something very perfectly fucking clear. I trust you and your boys 10 times more. We all do. Which is why we're giving you extra territory. And which is why we're talking to you like this. Because, honestly, after that conversation, we have to reevaluate some things. We can't go into detail, but when the time is right, we'll talk to you about it, okay?
Cool. Well, I'd like to, as common courtesy, exchange, some information that I'm sure you'd be glad to hear, too. We've been keeping things under the wraps a little bit from everybody, pretty much. But Angelo here, the gentleman right behind me, is training to become a doctor. So hopefully he'll be able to, open up a practice here in the city. And, if and when he does become a doctor, he'd be more than willing to, help you guys out whenever he's around, whenever he can.
Another thing, this has been in thought for a while. I know that the gunsmith, there hasn't really been a local gunsmith here in St. Denis since Port Crane, really.
Yeah, you're right.
So Goggles has been training rigorously. I mean, it's been fucking brutal for him. I pity the guy. To become a gunsmith now for months, and he's starting to get to a point where he'll be able to start sawing off some shotguns and things like that. And he was looking forward to opening a practicing gunsmith here in the city as well. So I understand that, you know, your office is right above there. I just wanted to let you know before, it just comes out of the blue, out of nowhere.
Yeah, I appreciate it. You have full permission to do so. Angelo, I wish you good luck on your doctoring, and I hope that benefits you and everyone else in the city. And Goggles, when he gets that done, will be more than welcome to him, you know. I mean, Goggles is a good guy. I don't have any doubt of his integrity as a person, so I trust him. He'll be a good gunsmith right below us.
Yeah, so I just wanted to bring that forward to you as a, sign of respect and gratitude, before anything happens out of the blue.
I appreciate you saying that. It goes a long way. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And then, like I said, Adam and Isaac here are opening up their smoke shop over by the greenhouse over by where Archie does Cassidy's. So there'll be we'll have some smokes for you guys to enjoy hopefully soon.
We do like the sound of that.
We do.
Yeah, we have a whole cigar catalog in the works.
That's good.
Sicilian rolls.
Sorry?
Sicilian rolls.
We're working on that. We'll look into it.
We can hook you up.
It might be a bit pricier,
could probably hear with Benny, probably make some.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, right now, I'll let you two talk about it a little bit more, but a lot of it's local. Most of the tobacco is from Guam, correct, fellas?
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Yeah, so, they got the good tobacco, and then, still working on everything. They just got their business license approved, so just getting the ball rolling here.
Can't wait to try it.
Yeah, that'll be exciting.
Yeah, believe it or not, Lip tried it out earlier, loved it.
Oh, that's good. He's usually shy about those things.
I know. I was very surprised, to be honest.
Yeah, no doubt. Well, I appreciate everything you guys have done. And if you guys need anything, please let us know, all right?
Of course. Likewise. Same thing with us.
You guys are more than welcome to have a chat with us anytime. We're going to get out of your hair.
Bring wine if you do.
You know me. Right, take it easy, fellas.
You too.
Take it easy.
All right, stay.
While it still seemed it was evident that a mess was in sight, this opened up some doors for us and allowed us to establish ourselves further within the city, primarily in our interactions with those who lived in our neighborhood, which I like to call Little Italy. Probably my favorite people in the neighborhood were Marietta and Luciano Romero, siblings originally from New York, who had just opened a genuine Italian barbershop in Little Italy, something I had been praying would happen in St. Denis. Right before their grand opening was planned, though, Marietta had sent me an urgent letter regarding some trouble she had come across.
For a second, I was about to go full charge in.
Jesus
Christ.
I had to go
hitch my horse off the street because the fucking carriage drivers keep bumping into my horse, you know.
Christ. What the hell happened to you?
Let's go sit down at the back because I'm finding it real hard to stand right now.
Yeah. Alright, so, you look a mess. What the hell happened?
Jesus Christ, right, so, I'm new to the city. I don't know a lot of people. I keep to myself. I mind my business. I don't really talk to a lot of people unless it's business related or just making friendly conversation. I stick to my books and that's about it. So, I'm sitting on the bench. outside the, you know, in front of the big saloon. They call it the Bastille.
Yeah, yeah.
Found right. Isaac, I don't know where Patty is.
I came looking for him.
So,
Isaac, you go look for him too, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
That's all right. I'm sitting on this bench. I'm minding my business. I'm reading a book. Then, I don't know, this guy, I've never seen him before, this little short guy comes up to me and he talks real funny. I don't know what kind of fucking accent he had, but he came up to me and he asked me, he made a comment about my outfit. I don't know. He said I look real nice. I said, thank you. And I kept it moving. Then he started asking me questions about the book I was reading. And I told him it's a romance novel. What about it, you know? Then he starts asking me if the book was about us. You know, trying to fucking flirt with me. I don't know. I told him, beat it, pal. I'm not fucking interested, you know? He kept pushing it. He kept trying to tell me that I should be nice to him. And I said, I'm not the type of person that's gonna take lightly to these kind of approaches, you know? And the guy, he tells me, you're lucky you're not rich. I would have gutted you by now. And I stood up to him and I told him, what? What the fuck did you say to me? I'm not the kind of person you want to threaten. And I've got a bit of a temper on me, I must admit. You know, I got a little bit heated. I got up to him and I squared up to him and I told him, beat it, pal. Like, get the fuck out of here. I don't want to see your face. Next thing I know, the guy pulls out a knife and he stabs me. I slapped him around a little bit, trying to defend myself. But I ain't got a fucking knife on me. I don't have a gun on me. I'm by myself. All right? I told the guy, beat it. Many times. Next thing I know, he slashes me up and leaves me on the ground to bleed out. I passed out, I don't know. Next thing I know, I wake up in the hospital and got this doctor lady looking over me. And some British guy helped me out, told me he found me. The cops came over, you know, deputies, they asked me a couple of questions. I fucking told them. I don't remember who did it. You know, I'm not the type of person who, let's just say I don't have a lot of faith in the deputies.
Yeah.
So, I didn't really tell them much information. I told them, look, I don't remember. It was some weird guy, some creep. He talked in a funny voice. That's it. But I know who the guy is. It's some fucking street urchin.
He, what's he look like?
He's short. He's real thin. He's got blonde hair. He's got like these kind of, I don't know, like red blotches and patches on his face. I don't know. He was wearing a green vest. He's running around with a little girl.
What the fuck? I know those two.
I think I know them as well.
Yeah, I saw them walking around earlier. Did he, what color shirt was he wearing?
I don't know.
Blue?
Maybe blue, maybe white. But I remember the vest was green and he had a flat cap.
Yeah, like mine?
Yeah, he had a flat cap on.
Okay. Yeah, I know the guy.
He's a fucking creep. The guy came up to me. I don't know what he was trying to say, you know? Like, you try to be nice at first. You tell him, you know, I'm not interested, pal. Keep it moving. And he just kept pushing it. And then when he threatened to gut me, next thing I know, the guy pulled out a knife.
These fucking kids. Animals. Unbelievable.
That's real fucking disrespectful, let me tell you.
All right. Was he with this girl at the time, or was he just by himself?
He was with the girl, yeah.
Hmm.
She didn't do nothing. She just stood there. She barely said anything.
Yeah.
But she, I gotta admit, she did tell him, you know, she didn't say stop, but she looked a little frightened. She looked like she wasn't expecting him to do that. Hmm. She was, at first she was, I noticed she was laughing and giggling, you know, when he first approached me.
Alright. Well, thank you for bringing this to my attention. How are you holding up?
I got a couple stab wounds. I got my biceps torn up real bad. I had to get some stitches on it, but the doctor, she told me to let it rest, to change my bandages at home every day, and should be back to normal. But in the meantime, I'm not going to be able to open up my business anytime soon because of this. I need my hands to do my job, you know?
Fucking Jamal.
Yeah, I'm real sorry about that, but...
Man, it's not your fault. The best thing for you now is just to, you know, rest up and make yourself as healthy as you can. Well, I'll look into it, see what I can do. Do you, you know, ever want to see this guy again, or, you know, do you not really care about him, or, how do you feel about him?
The guy's a fucking lunatic, alright? Any kind of guy who approaches a lady like that and is willing to fucking try to take her life for saying no, that's a fucking scumbag right there. I don't want to ever fucking see him again. I don't care. I don't want no fucking apology.
Alright.
You can do whatever you want. But, you know, you told me yesterday at the restaurant, if I had a problem, I'd come to you, so... Sticking by that.
Yeah, you don't gotta worry about nothing about this guy no more. I'll see today. This could not stand. And so we looked into the matter. And hopefully, we'll have everything resolved shortly. But the real issue is the tension over Saint Denis right now. Something is bound to happen.
Mr. Barletti.
You're interrupting me right now, Angelo. What the hell's going on?
You two guests of honor are ready for you.
Alright, we'll be right there. Adam.
Said I was wanted upstairs.
Put the goggles.
Cut the head off. You want the body into six pieces, right? So you cut the head off, cut both of the arms off, both of the legs. Shave the head, pull the teeth out. And then we'll go. You're gonna feed each individual piece to different gators. Not all to the same one, because you'll throw it back up. And that's where you'll find the evidence, you know what I mean?
Right.
So, which one? It dip dog shit. I don't know. Alright, let's get started.
Hold on a second there, Patty.
Wait!
Danny, is that right?
Yes.
Have my associates informed you of any particular reason why you've ended up in this situation?
No.
No. Is it because I have... No, I don't know. I was going to say it's because I have a sausage and some people don't, but... No, it's not that.
I can assure you it's not because you have a sausage.
Please.
You see... You came across a good friend of mine a couple of weeks back. Her name was Mrs. Romero. Dark hair, dark clothing. Accent similar to mine. Does it ring any bells?
Don't know anyone called that.
Yeah, I don't either.
Is that so?
Yeah, I've never met anyone good.
Well, I believe you happened to encounter her in the park here in the city. You know, maybe you were trying to speak with her and she didn't really want to speak with you. That sounded a little bit more familiar.
It sounds a little bit more familiar. I know what you're talking about now.
Oh, you do?
Yes. You said that she was going to come for my families.
Oh, is that so?
Yeah.
Yes.
Because the way I heard it, it was very different. The way I heard it, you were harassing her on the street, following her around.
He just said she was pretty.
I said, I walked up to her and I said that she was pretty, and then she started shouting at me and having a go at me for being nice.
You only said this one time.
What, that she looked nice?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I said, you look nice, and then she started having a go at me, and then I explained myself, saying that, yes, I said that you look nice, so why are you now shouting at me? I just said you're nice.
He asked her what she was reading.
Did she seem like she didn't really want to be spoken to at the time?
Yeah, because she was shouting at me, isn't it?
Yeah.
Getting all funnies with me.
But never before that, she's just seemed kind of lonely.
So we went and talked to her, and then she was being rude.
It is a story.
It's really hurting. Can please?
The story you're telling me, it.
Hey, girls, they're speaking a tad bit too loud.
Well. You heard the man?
I can't even hear Mr. Barletti.
I'd appreciate it if you, would lower your voices a little bit. Or, we might have some problems.
I didn't know I had to whisper.
Yeah, I thought we were in a room.
So, what you're telling me, it's just, it's just not adding up.
Well, you didn't let me finish.
Well, by all means.
She started getting up in my face, telling me to leave, and how she hates me for coming up to talk to us. Obviously not word for word, but I'm telling you what happened. And because she was getting rude and talking about my families, I pulled my knife to see if she would go away, to scare her, because I didn't know what to do. She was being rude and everything. She then punched me when I pulled out my knife, so I stabbed her. And we got in a little scuffle. And my knife got hers. I didn't intend on hurting her with a knife. I was just trying to scare her.
Well, you see, that's the problem. You can't just pull a knife on somebody in the middle of a friggin' park. So, she was a mess when she came to me and told me about this whole ordeal. I think, you're both young, so I think, sometimes people who don't know what to do in certain situations, they have to be taught.
Okay.
Educate, right?
Blouse. Educate means not winners.
What's that?
When you educate means and not winners.
Yeah. I tend to educate you both, but in, different ways.
Okay.
A minute here. Yeah. Alright. Neither of them have weapons.
Off the sound.
Alright, let's bring Miss Winnie over here to this side of the room. Stand her up, but keep her hands bound.
Alright, I'll get this over here. Just remember, don't want to try anything funny. Stand up against the wall.
Which way?
You can face this way. Well, let's just have her tie her hands behind the back, and we'll need to put her on the ground or not.
Alright. Let me tie your hands.
Okay.
There you go. Back up against the wall, if you don't mind.
Alright, let's do the same with him.
Again, no funny business.
Nope. None at all.
Let's have him over here. On his pole. Back to that pole.
Right here to this pole.
Okay.
Angelo, can you block the stairs?
Mm-hmm. Alright, Danny. So, you see, you've really put me in quite a predicament. Because you hurt a very dear friend of mine. My barber, nonetheless. Somebody very important to me. So, you know, the way I like to do things is, I'm a fair man. You hurt my friend, so, you know, I think that the best way to educate you about, you know, some of the things, the actions that you've taken, is to, you know, maybe make you feel some of their pain, right? Maybe no. That way it'll teach you maybe to not do this again. So, Miss Winnie's lesson here is that she gets to watch, because it seems as though that's what happened when you hurt my dear friend, Miss Romero. So maybe she'll learn that when somebody that she cares about gets hurt, maybe, you know, she shouldn't just stand by and let things happen. And, you know, maybe just next time she'll speak up and tell somebody to stop.
Wait a second. One second.
I'm all ears.
The problem with some people is that they don't understand.
They don't understand what?
I'm just suggesting that maybe hurting someone isn't the best way to teach them something. Maybe you just sit them down and talk to them.
Well,
I know you're angry. I'm sorry. I'll do anything else. I'll work for you. I'm pretty smart.
See, now, Danny, it's just not gonna work.
Why not? Please.
Because believe me, I grew up in the biggest city in the world. I know your type. And sometimes, you know, the words, they all... Maybe they'll stick for a day, 2 days, a week. But, you know, there's just something wired wrong in your head, right? To just pull out a knife and stab somebody in the middle of the road, middle of the park. I mean, you don't see anything wrong with pulling out a knife and threatening somebody in public like that.
I do now that you say it, but my families, wouldn't you have done the same thing? You were scared because they threatened your families? Do you not see that? Please, sir, please.
Look, Danny, there's people who react impulsively. And there's people who react accordingly. Impulsively means you draw your knife and stab somebody because they threaten your family on the spot.
Okay.
Reacting accordingly means that you think things through a little bit. So maybe, by getting your bell rung a little bit, maybe it'll rewire things to help you think things through a little bit next time. Capiche?
I don't really... I mean, I understand, but it's a bit far. You could just talk to me and I won't do it.
See, the damage has already been done. The way I see it, we've done our talking, so... Now it's time for you to, you know, maybe feel a little bit of, you know, what Miss Romero felt, so.
What if I told you that I have a lot of money hidden in a ways?
Hidden away, huh?
Yes.
Now where might this money be hidden?
I'll go get it.
No. And it's just, I grew up, I had a somewhat of a similar background to you, I'm sure. Now, in my day, when you made a mistake, the next day you are filled with bruises and shiners and, you know, broken bones. See, this helped me learn. Well, now, but I'd like to pass on like everything you. That I've learned.
Please.
To you.
Sir, please.
And I've learned to see through lies.
See through
like the
lies.
One you just told me.
Do you know, I washed the big old courthouse for a man, and he paid me a lot of monies.
Look, Danny.
I told you I cleaned the thing for Dr. Jesus. Wait, I didn't tell you that, but it's true. I clean, and that's why we came here today, is because we wanted to clean the pawn shop for you. That's what we wanted to do. And seriously, I have money. I'll give it to you. I just didn't want to. I'll go get it.
I don't want your money, because I want to ensure that the same mistakes will not be made again in this city.
Yeah. And there won't be, I won't do it.
Yeah, I'll make sure of that.
Please. Oh, sorry.
You're never gonna fuck with anybody in this fucking city again, you understand?
Oh.
Do you understand?
Yes.
And when people have an issue with you, you're not just gonna draw your knife and fucking stab them in the arm. You understand?
Yes. My nose.
Stay right there.
No.
And Miss Mwenny.
Yeah.
Next time you see your brother about to do something stupid, I think it would be in both of your best interest if you recommended to him that he stops. Is that understood?
Yeah.
Now, you see, I have a place in my heart for little girls. I pity them, you know? And I could see that you clearly care about your sister there. So what I'm gonna do is, I'll let you take her punishment for her. That sound good to you?
Just, yes. Just leave one out.
I intend to. I don't fuck with anybody else in this city, alright?
Or do you want me to leave him?
I'll leave that up to you.
Alright. I'll bring Adam with me.
Yep.